Hi, I'm Dr. Charlie Messa, and this is an episode of No Spin Live. I'm here today with two highly regarded expert plastic surgeons, Dr. Mark Epstein from Long Island, New York, and Dr. Ned Snyder from Austin, Texas.
Hi there.
How you doing?
Hey, guys. Good to see you. Patients are always looking to see what options are available to reduce and improve body contour, especially in the midsection, especially now that patients have been staying home, less active, the gyms are closed, watching a lot of Netflix, eating a lot of extra food. So I like to hit on that topic. So when patients, once we're clear of the pandemic, we can kind of get back to work, what they might expect or what they might look for. So I'll start with Mark. You know, I know you have a lot of high technology in your office and you have some of the latest techniques in non-invasive body contouring. What would you recommend for patients coming in the lower abdominal area in particular?
Well, I've been using radiofrequency tightening for several years, and currently I'm using BodyTite, which I think is probably the best technology. But when you're talking about the lower abdomen, I think nothing is going to give the results that you're going to get with surgery. I think that BodyTite by itself will work in some cases where the deformity isn't that bad, or I'll use it as an adjunct to get a little extra oomph out of results. Maybe I'm doing liposuction, I want a little bit of contraction, so I'll do the BodyTite. But you can't replace liposuction and or tummy tuck with a non-surgical option and expect to get the same results. It's not gonna happen.
Right, and I know, Ned, you offer so similar non-invasive technology.
Yeah, I was gonna say we have cool sculpting and we have M-Sculpt machines. And so mm-hmm. both of them really kind of complement themselves pretty well. The M-Sculpt is a muscle building and the cool sculpting is sort of a fat dissolving. I know they're gonna be busy as we ramp back up, and one that as surgery is relatively slow and people are looking for non-surgical alternatives. And in addition, just that our surgery schedules are going to be so busy that we won't be able to get to everybody as well that we maybe would have been able to service this spring and summer.
Right. What kind of results do you see with the cool sculpting in terms of fat reduction and that longevity of it?
So great question. In terms of the original data that they did, if you do one round of cool sculpting on an area, you lose some 22 or 23% of that fat. Mm-hmm. If you do a second round of that, of cool sculpting, you lose right at 50% of that fat. What we don't have MRI data on, but we have good clinical data on, is if we call it stacking, but basically you mm-hmm. just put the first one and the first data was just based on doing the second round within 4 weeks. If you put the device on, take it off, massage it, and then put it right back, massage the tissue and put the device right back on, we lose about 2/3 of that fat.
Really?
So in that sense, you can lose as much fat as you might want to with liposuction. As Dr. Epstein pointed out, that there's no way that you're going to get the control that you will with surgery or be able to get the same results that you might get. But if the device heads fit somebody just right, the love handles, some area on their abdomen, some of the places that we want to see some mm-hmm. real specific reductions in fat, you can get extremely good results.
Right. I know.
I've seen some very good results with the cool scoping, but it's a little bit unpredictable. We also do the second round of treatments about 4 to 6 weeks apart. Now we're coupling it with cool tone. We don't have the M-Sculpt, but it's the same thing, high intensity electromagnetic field. And I was the first one to use it, so I'm waiting to see what happens.
So now what when patients say, okay, I know the M-Sculpt and the cool tone are supposed to increase muscle tone and increase the overall tone of the tissue. So when a patient says, okay, now do I have to go to the gym anymore? I'm all set. Now I got a six pack. I'm ready to go. What do you tell them about maintenance and longevity?
Yeah, there are people who come in and they want the six pack. And there are some people that, like myself, no matter how much M-Sculpt or cool tone you do, I don't think you're going to get the six pack because I'm a little bit older. I got a little bit more subcutaneous fat, mm-hmm. not a lot, and some skin laxity. And that goes against getting definition. So for someone like me, getting the tone, the muscle tone, is important. And I noticed that. I was telling my brother about it. He's an anesthesiologist and was asking me about his abdomen. And I told him what I was doing. He poked me in the abdomen with one finger and almost broke his finger. He said, wow, that's pretty intense. And I noticed when I get up from a lying position or whatnot, my core is stronger. I have a bad back. I've got herniated disc. I have had no problems since I began doing these treatments.
That's great.
That's only, you know, anecdotal. That's just me. We've started doing some other patients. The machine came out fairly recently. M-Sculpt's been out a lot longer. So, you know, we'll see. The magnetic field is at least as strong as the M-Sculpt. So, and it's interesting, the algorithms that they use during the treatments so that you don't have any pain afterwards, the way they pulse the muscles and force the lactic acid out. It's pretty incredible technology.
Right. So the cool tone is supposed to be less painful if they and the side by side, you know, or is it about the same?
I turn the cool tone up to 100% when I do it.
The M Sculpt isn't painful. So I mean, you in the beginning you start people low just because you it's something you've never felt before, but right. It's not painful.
It feels good.
An important point to make about the reason that we get such muscle building with both of these technologies is that, or it's the same technology with both devices, is that you're recruiting muscle fibers that you just don't get in when you're doing exercise. Right. That they may have been muscle fibers that were available to you when you were developing or a teenager or some point when you had some real improving athletic potential. But as an adult, we don't use all of our muscle fibers to the full extent. And so you recruit them, you develop them, and then they stay somewhat activated and stay. And so we're able to use them then following that. And that's partly why it's so muscle building and why the muscle lasts, because you begin to use it then following that.
Interesting thing was, I did a 30-minute treatment, got up, zero discomfort as with all the treatments, then did a 5-hour surgery with no issue whatsoever.
Really? That's great.
It's amazing technology. You put this thing on top of you and you go, you know, this isn't going to do much. And then all of a sudden your muscles are cranking like you've never felt in your life. And it's just amazing.
Now, so for the patients that have a little bit of laxity, superficial laxity, you're going to recommend the body tight system. Or the radio frequency lipolysis, or are you going to, what do you determine in terms of doing, how you can do like a mini tummy tuck if they have a little bit of laxity versus doing the body tight system?
That's a great question. I want to assess what their goals are, because I do high definition liposculpture. So if I feel that I can get high definition from them, you know, that involves selective removal of fat at different layers, and that you're not going to see with cool sculpting or body tight. So I'll offer that. If there's excess skin that I don't think is going to retract with body tight, then I'm going to recommend at least a mini abdominoplasty. And the body tight is just to get a little extra tightening. If they say all they want to do is just get some skin tightening and nothing else, then we just do the body tight as a standalone. I've seen a lot of people show their before and afters with some impressive results with body tight on the abdomen, where there's been a fair amount of significant fat. And you look at the results and go, yeah, that's pretty impressive, but that's not the kind of results that my patients want. They want more evacuation of fat than these people are showing.
Right. And you brought up a good point, the high definition liposculpture, which a lot of people are asking for, because you can, for both males and females, you can give them a more defined abdomen where you highlight the natural musculature. So it almost looks like they have a six pack or that kind of sculpted waistline. Ned, do you use the PAL system with the high def lipo as well?
I do. Yeah. I use PAL for all of that. Have access to ultrasound assisted, but I really use the power assisted for that. I think I have better results.
Right. Now,
combining them?
I have, but it ends up being complicated to use two different machines. And so I do that less frequently, in all honesty. But I think that I get great results with the PAL, and I kind of use the ultrasound assisted much less.
Do you use the Vaser for ultrasound or a different system?
Vaser, yeah.
I found that for an abdomen, flank, back, Vaser, I like to pre-emulsify the fat. Outer thighs, inner thighs, arms, PAL alone is fine.
Right, so for patients out there, just to clarify, so the Vaser means it's a type of internal ultrasound, or like using ultrasound waves to heat the fat as well as remove it. So you're kind of combining multiple technologies, correct?
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah. That's right.
So, so when a patient has that loose extra skin, that kind of panis of fat, that's a patient you're going to do an abdominoplasty on. So, do you combine your Vaser technique with abdominoplasty, or just traditional liposuction in that case?
About 95% of the time, I combine them. I like to do a lipoabdominoplasty. I get better three-dimensional sculpting that way. Mm-hmm. Only a patient who comes in with really no excess fat, they don't have, as we say, two fat cells to rub together, they'll get a straightforward abdominoplasty. But if they've got any excess fat where I feel I can get the advantage of the sculpting, I'll do the lipoabdominoplasty.
Yeah, I agree with that too. I think most of my abdominoplasties, almost all of them, will have some component of liposuction.
Do you like to the lipo on the abdominal flap as well, or just the flanks?
I'll do it on the upper abdominal flap, in particular that part that sits over the rib cage, that fat pad. If you don't either dissect all the way up to nearly the breast fold, you end up with this extra fat that just sits over the rib cage. So almost always liposuction that, and then just depending on how extended the abdominoplasty is. But I do a lot of circumferential abdominoplasties now, just for skin laxity posteriorly, and you end up excising a lot of that fat. So you really just need a small amount of liposuction for contouring in that sense.
Right, and a lot of patients will, you know, when we start talking about abdominoplasty, their two biggest concerns are pain and scars. So is there any techniques that you're using to reduce pain in the perioperative period?
I've been using Exparel probably for about 6 or 7 years. Whenever it first came out, I adopted it right away. A total game changer in my practice. It's nice because you can use it on a regular abdominoplasty, or if you're doing a circumferential, you could just dilute it up and use it all the way around with no loss of potency. But it's been a huge game changer in reduction of pain.
Yeah, I agree with that. And also, from a perioperative standpoint, we give everybody Tylenol and gabapentin and use ketamine during the case, and then everybody gets gabapentin afterwards. So we've used a lot less narcotics than we used to in that perioperative period, I think.
Right. How about drains?
Drains, it's funny. Years ago, I used drains for all my tummy tucks and breast reductions and none of my liposuctions. Now I use drains on most all my liposuctions and none of my tummy tucks and none of my breast reductions.
Right, so you're doing the sequential, tacking the down the flap.
The progressive tension sutures.
Right.
I like the quill barb sutures. Those laser cut barbs work real well. And our seroma rate after, it's not zero, but it is so much less than when I use drains.
Right. That's good. Ned, same thing for you?
I do that as well, but I often will put a drain in and just knowing that they're going to come out sooner. All circumferential patients, I've put drains in posteriorly because you just have to. And if I'm putting one in posteriorly, I'll usually put one in anteriorly, just knowing it may come out a few days later.
Yeah.
But I think it's sort of cut down our seroma rate to minimal, to, you know, can't say none, but to nearly none.
No, that's great. A lot of great ideas, a lot of great things for patients to think about as they're coming out of the quarantine. Two experts in the field of body contouring in all areas of plastic surgery. So for more information on body contouring and other facets of plastic surgery, please take a look at theplasticsurgerychannel.com. Thank you.